early 2024, a slew of these went up into low Earth orbit. All right, guys, today we're gonna print this part in ULTEM 1010 on the 22IDEX V3, and I'm gonna show you the whole process from start to finish so that you know exactly what to expect when you receive your machine. So this part, it's actually an intelligent protected lithium battery module that is launched up into space and handles many different voltages. Now, you might ask, why ULTEM 1010? Why not PEEK or something made out of metal like titanium? And the main reason is actually off-gassing. So these parts, they did originally injection mold, but they needed to customize them and have different sensor outputs and different plugs and things like that. So 3D printing them proved a lot better for their application because they could make adjustments on the fly and modify it for any type of battery pack. Now, the off-gassing is really just to meet the ASTM standard, which talks about how much mass is lost when the part is at elevated temperatures in a vacuum environment. So very interesting stuff. A lot of things in space, a lot of times it's chemical resistance or radio transparency or something like that. But in this case, it's all about off-gassing. So let's dive right in and take our 3D model, get it sliced, loaded into the machine, and let's start printing. Now, the first thing you always wanna do is make sure that you start with dry material. So the night before, or at least 4 to 6 hours of baking the material in an oven, like our lab grade vacuum oven that we actually sell at visionminer.com, is very, very important because it gets rid of any of the moisture still contained in the polymer, which pretty much every polymer has moisture, and you gotta remove it before you melt it because it'll create steam bubbles and little pockets and things that affect the mechanical properties as well as the surface finish and quality of the parts. So you wanna make sure that your filament is super, super dry before you start the print. The next thing you're gonna wanna do is preheat the machine. When you're printing in high temp, you wanna make sure that you soak the machine in heat. This is really important to maintain consistency throughout the part from the first layer to the last layer so that your part has good mechanical properties, surface finish, and everything else. So one of the first things you want to do is take your cool carbon fiber build plate, which is included with the machine and works for just about every polymer, and apply the nanopolymer adhesive to it. Now this is our special glue that we made years ago specifically for high temp materials. Now, we know the size of the part, it's gonna be right there in the middle, so that's all I really need to apply. And I'm just gonna sort of, spread it around, get that whole area nice and coated, and then I can go ahead and pop this into the machine. All right, so we're just gonna slide this in here, and then I'm just gonna tighten these little bolts down, just finger tight. Now, if you've already preheated the machine, those nuts are gonna be very hot, so make sure you wear some gloves. All right, so let's go over to the control panel and let's get the machine raised up to temperature. All right, so we come over here to our dashboard in Duet Web Control, and we're gonna set our temperature. So we've got the bed heater set to 160, and that's heating back up, as you can see right here in the temperature chart. That's when we opened the door and slid in the build plate. So the chamber is also coming up, which we've got set to 90. Now you'll see down here, nothing has been homed. That's totally fine. That'll be all automatic once we get to that next step. So the machine's heating up, and if it hadn't been hot already, you'd wanna let this sit for about an hour or so until the machine is warm to the touch. You wanna make sure all that metal gets nice and heat soaked. Next, we're gonna open up PrusaSlicer. All right, so we've got our platter here, and this is our slicer. So I'm gonna go ahead and grab my file. This is an STL file, and I'll just drop it right in there. So we can see the orientation, the direction it's facing. This is the front of the build plate, so we're gonna see it right there. And that middle part, which we coated in nano adhesive, we're good to go. Now, there's a couple things on this part, because we have printed it in the past, so we know that we're gonna wanna actually disable supports in these overhangs because we don't need them, and then we'll set up regular supports for the rest of the machine. But the first thing we're gonna do is gonna come over here and select the 3DX Tech Thermax PEI 1010 profile so that all my temperatures and everything are set up to the appropriate values. Now, those may need adjusting depending on the part geometry, size, and difficulty. So just know we do include these profiles, but they are starting points. The world of high temp is still kind of the Wild West, so the different geometries and shapes and sizes of parts are all kind of a little bit different. might need to adjust a couple things. Usually it's very slight. So from here, we've got this, and I'm gonna go right here to the paint on supports tool. Now you can see here, it tells me right mouse button blocks supports. So I could paint left mouse button, and that's gonna enable supports there, but we don't need that. I'm gonna right click just in these areas and just sort of paint these overhangs so we don't get any support material in there. Very simple, very easy, very quick. And you have different brush modes and everything down here to do that. Next, what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna hit slice and see what it does. See how the supports are set up. Okay, so we've got support material. We got some very thin support under this thin dual extrusion or dual wall section. So that'll be good. Everything's looking solid, but I can also come in and check here and so check the support material, because by default, this will be disabled. The auto-generated supports, the overhang thresholds and everything are all set up to be at a good midpoint depending on your part. And we're gonna choose, instead of organic, which would create support structures that look like this, we're actually gonna use snug. And that'll give us just a little bit less support, and it's all gonna be sort of tighter into the geometry of the part. And we found that worked well. All right, so from there, that's about all we got. We do see these little overhang areas which come out just fine on the actual part, and we should be essentially good to go. If I want, I can double check my print temperatures and whatnot in here. We're looking good, 390 on the nozzle and 160 on the bed for this part. And we're good to go. So we've got our slice. I can now just export the G code and save that as today's print. So as far as speeds go, we're actually using an algorithm to do volumetric flow based on the speed and the layer time of the part. And this has worked pretty well. If you want just a brass tacks, make it work, it should work pretty well. You can default to 30 millimeters a second, but we like pushing boundaries here and discovering the next layer of the envelope. So we use some new settings that are constantly in development. And we're going actually, let's see, we can go here and look at actual speed. So we can see all these different colors, and this orange is actually looking like 70 or 80 millimeters a second. Whereas a lot of the yellow is closer to 50, and then a lot of areas in here are closer down to 30 and as low as 10 millimeters a second. So this is gonna be an interesting print, but it's optimizing speed based on layer time, which seems to have a really good effect on layer adhesion, which is the toughest part in a high temp material like this. So we're gonna go back over to print settings and check out the speed. When it comes to speed, you'll notice that it is set to 100 millimeters a second here, but what you really want to look at is the max volumetric speed. That is what's going to set the dynamic flow rate to keep it as close to a certain flow throughout the print as it can. So you don't necessarily just do speed, but you could override all this and set the maximums and whatnot. But we're finding in testing that volumetric speed is actually a much better way to do it. Okay, so I can go ahead and export my G code. It's gonna take the part file name and just make that the G code. So I could say PEI 1010 and put the date, or is it 09/05/24, and save. So now we're gonna go back into our Duet Web Control. And I have two options here. I could just hit this button, upload and start, and grab that file, and it would automatically start the print. Or I could go to jobs and upload it here. So let me go ahead and upload G-code, grab that latest file, and open. Now it's gonna upload it, and it'll be there, ready to go. Next, we're gonna have to load the filament into the machine, and then we'll be able to start printing. So let's go ahead and do that. So now we gotta load the filament. So we've got over here our trusty vacuum chamber. If you don't already have one of our lab grade vacuum ovens, then you can actually use any oven, or you can bake the filament inside the machine and then use one of our vacuum chambers after the fact to pull that moisture out. Now, the vacuum lowers the boiling point of moisture, which means it off-gases and turns into a gas, which means it's much easier to get out of the filament. So the vacuum chamber is really, really a critical part of drying filaments, especially high-temp filaments. It really speeds up the process and limits the amount of degradation you can have by baking filament over and over and over and over and over. So we're gonna take this, we're gonna open this up and get our filament out. All right, now you wanna be really quick with this because ULTEM especially will absorb moisture very fast. We're gonna go straight over to the machine, we're gonna go straight over to the workstation, and we're going to say load filament. We're gonna choose PEI 1010 or 9085, and it's going to heat up the nozzle to an appropriate temperature for the material that is selected. So then we're gonna get our filament ready here, and we're gonna go ahead and open the chamber. The bed is gonna drop down to give you room to put the spool on, and we're gonna load it in and then feed it up through into the nozzle, and it'll automatically grab it and drop it down through and start extruding some filament. All right, now the first thing it's gonna do is it's gonna home itself so that it knows where the build plate is before it drops it all the way down. I'm gonna go ahead and open this up. I'm gonna put my spool on here, and I am going to feed it up through this little nub right here until it stops. I'm just gonna keep feeding it until I feel it sort of stop. There we go. I'm gonna close the chamber door again, and we're going to go back over to the machine and say extrude. And then we're gonna watch the nozzle to see if we got any material coming out. As it's going, it feels like it caught. I can't pull it back out, so that means it's in there. And it's extruding. So we have extrusion. I'm just gonna grab this off the nozzle, and while I'm in there, I like to be extra safe and actually clean off the nozzle just to make sure there's less chance for blobs and globs and things like that. So I'm gonna go in here and wipe this thing off with a wire brush. Okay, there we go. We'll come back over here. Filament is extruding, so I will press yes. All right, now the machine is ready to go. It's loaded and we can start our print. Okay, so all we gotta do is select our file that we uploaded and say, yes, we wanna start the print. So that's going to take everything, and our chamber is gonna come back up to temperature because we just had the door open. Our bed is set and good, and our nozzles are gonna start heating up as well. Okay, so now really all we gotta do is wait for the part to finish. Now we do like to always watch that first layer. It's the most important time to make sure that your print is going well. If the first layer's not good, the rest of the part's not gonna be good. So you want us to hang around for 10 minutes or so to watch that first layer go down smooth and clean, and then you're pretty much good to go until the part's finished. So this part will take about an hour. We're gonna watch this first layer, and we'll come back and show you how to remove the part. All right, the print has finished and we are back. So it's time to take it out of the machine and take it off the plate, get the supports off, and we're done. So let's go ahead and do that. I would recommend, I like wearing leather gloves. These are a little bit more dexterous than big welder's gloves, but the machine is very hot. So you do wanna be careful as you go in here and remove the plate. But it is as simple as going in, loosen each of the little four corner bolts just a little bit, and then slide the plate right out. All right, so we're gonna get our part over here, and then you could let the plate sort of sit there for 10 minutes or put it on cold concrete. Oh, you can already hear it. You can hear it releasing from the plate. So that's something really cool about our carbon fiber build plates and nanopolymer adhesive, is that the adhesive itself activates at high temperature. So if you're doing PLA, it activates around 50 or 60 Celsius. But for the high temp materials, you know, you're putting much, much higher and it survives that. But as you can hear, the part itself is releasing as the plate cools down. You can actually see it right here that part is about to release on its own. You can hear the little crackling. Very, very cool. If I were to let this part cool on glass, there's a 90% chance it would pull chunks of glass out, which is the reason we developed our carbon fiber plates in the first place. It's basically removing itself from the plate, but I'm gonna use it, I'm gonna help it along with a little scraper tool right there. And there we have it. So there's our part. Very nice. I'm gonna remove the gloves. Now, depending on the part can still be very, very hot. This part's very thin-walled, so it cooled down very quickly. So I'm able to handle it with my hands with no problem. Now let's see how it is taking off the supports. There we go. So a lot of times you can just take it off by hand. Sometimes you do need to get in there with tools, especially on more complex support structures or materials like PEEK. There we go, look at that, just came right off. And sometimes you gotta get into little areas. There's this little nub, so I'm actually gonna get in there with the, sometimes a razor blade, sometimes tweezers or something else. You can get the rest of the support material out. So here I'll just take a little X-Acto blade, I can fit it down into that slot and pull out that support. So if you're going between these four parts, you can tell there's definitely slightly different qualities of each one, and they were printed with slightly different settings. Perhaps this one had two extrusions and a little bit of gap fill. Now you could adjust that to be just two smooth extrusions and get that smooth wall there without any artifacting or ghosting. Or you could go and actually design the part to be a specific width so that wouldn't happen in the first place. And that comes down to design for additive manufacturing, or DFAM, D-F-A-M. Really, really important in addition to knowing your machinery and how it behaves with different materials. The rheology and how the liquid molten polymers flow is different for everything. So just know before you get into this that each part's gonna have multiple correct answers for how you tune it, but it's gonna depend on how you like it or need it for your application. And there we have it, our ULTEM 1010 space grade part that is actually in service. Pumpkin did say we couldn't tell you the mission or the exact dates and whatnot that it went up, but early 2024, a slew of these went up into low Earth orbit. So just proof in the pudding that making stuff in these materials, whether you're a multi-billion dollar corporation in aerospace or you're somebody in your garage making really high temp parts that are going on a race car, regardless, this machine will help you do all of those things. All right, guys, so that is the process start to finish. We're here to demystify this machinery and these processes so that you can start using them in your business for a fraction of the cost of what was before possible. So we're here to help, we consult, and help you even with the legwork learning these materials, because it's our bread and butter for the last 8 years, and we're here to share with the community and the industry on how we get these amazing parts done and how you can too. The best use for a 3D printer is to save time and make money. And here at Vision Miner, that's what we're trying to do. That's what we're making happen. That's what we're helping our customers do as we push the industry forward to using these advanced thermoplastics in many different applications. With that being said, this is our bread and butter. We sell these machines and we help you use them along with 3D scanners and a bunch of other advanced additive manufacturing technologies. So give us a call or shoot us an email if you need help picking a machine, picking a material, or finishing your project. We're here to help you. Anyway, leave us a comment down below. What material or part do you want to see us print next? We've got a lot of these videos in the pipeline and a ton of support videos for the 22 IDEX. So you can rest assured you'll have a great time with the machine. But other than that, thanks for watching. Have a positive rest of your day. I'll see you on the next video.